Two things that I want to discuss today is the hypofocal lengths and why a shallow depth of field is maybe not really something you want to have. And both are related to each other, roughly. You will find a lot of lens calculators, of course, for your iPhone, for the iPad, for your computer, and many, many other areas, perhaps. What I want to give you here is, of course, the hyperfocal lengths that we need to know to have a peace of mind when we are shooting, and why these lines here shouldn't be very close to each other. So let's get started. From the start, we need to know which frame we have. If we have a full frame or a smaller one or 4/3, that means the sensor size by itself. And then we need to know which lens lengths we have. And we can set this up here, and you see here this is the view. And from there we can start then to adjust what we want. I think 35 is maybe a fairly nice lens for panoramas. It's maybe not the fastest lens when you want to shoot one time around with few shots, then maybe a 14 millimeter lens or even 8 millimeter lens is much faster, but the resolution from the panorama is then much smaller. So having said that, what we need to know about the hyperfocal lengths, and there are many different opinions about, but roughly we can say everything behind the hyperfocal lengths is fairly sharp. So in this case here, with this setting, aperture to f.1, 1.0, the hyperfocal length is way beyond anything that we have set here up. And we have to think about what we really want. When you have seen the series about parallax, then you know already a panorama should contain only objects that are in distance. So we don't have anything close to it, and each little camera move would give away that we have no parallax in it. The distance here allows us to move the camera without giving away that the background is just a panorama. And that is exactly where we are after normally. And so we need to know after which point everything is sharp, because in the moment we have some blurry stuff in the picture, nothing sharp, we give away that we have an image in it, even if we have everything in distance. So we want to have everything in distance, but we want to have it also fairly sharp. The first thing that we need to understand is, of course, the aperture. And f means here it's a mathematical value only, and an aperture of 1 divided by 1.0, that is here the slash always, means that the lens length by itself is the diameter of the diaphragm of the aperture, the hole in the lens where everything goes through. And this is just a measurement. It has nothing to do with all the class elements in it. So you can buy maybe a lens that has, for example, here a 2.0, and you think you have a wonderful lens. But the lens class by itself, and I've said that before, could be nearly plaque, because it's only mathematical here that the diameter is 35 millimeter, and within 2.0 it would be 17.5. So how much light finally hits the sensor is not a given here with this number. The real values are expressed with a T stop. T1 divided by 2 would mean that the light that goes in is really measured. And so a T stop is normally higher than the F stop. It's pretty much the same measurement, but it's only one time with class, one time without, to say it in a nutshell. So what we need to know here with the aperture is, of course, that it is directly related, based on the frame size here, how much depth of field I have. And the yellow line here, as you can see, is the focal distance. That is where everything is sharp. And then it goes to the green or to the orange one, where we have our focus, our depth of field. And this here is considered a shallow depth of field. So there's only here the little cat foot is sharp, and everything else turns more and more into blurry. That would be nothing that we can use for panoramic photography for 3D. So what we need to do here is, of course, to stop down the lens. and then we get even the dog head sharper. More importantly would be to change the focus length. So we go here more into the distance, and I think even a car in this size is too close to us. 6 meters, that gives parallax away, so we have to go further. Maybe we say 10 meters. That would be already a good value, and with an aperture of 8, we can see here the hyperfocal length is already closer to us, so we have everything here fairly sharp. Nothing is unsharp in the area where we want to have our panorama done. So why we don't use here the aperture just totally down to 32 or something like that, if your lens give that. Normally 22 is the max, sometimes even less. Because it is a misconception that I have to face more than often when I introduce people to photography. The first thing that you notice is wide open, everything is a little bit blurry, and only few lenses have already with maybe 1.2 or 1.3 some sharpness in it, even here where you have pulled the focus to. And it goes radically sharper when you go here to 2.0 or to 2.8. Good lenses start here already. And then you have lenses that you need to stop down to 5.6 or even up to 11 to get a really sharp image where you have the focus distance set. So when you have found maybe this point where you get a nice picture, then you think, okay, let's crank it up. More helps more. And that's of course not true. The smaller this opening is, the less light goes in and the less glass you use finally. That means also the resolution or the resolving power of the lens goes radically down. And that is the reason why we normally don't stop down this way. In film, we decide which depth of field we want to have, and then we use ND filters because the time is fixed. We can't change this. It should be always a very specific way to keep the look along the whole movie, which is also in discussion at the moment. So I give no numbers here. So what we want to do here is, of course, to find the sweet spot. And the sweet spot is something where the lens gives me the most depth of field, performs in the sharpest way, and has not stopped down to get here really the light in. So that's always a measurement, that is always a battle where we find the best thing. I have found most often, if I have no idea about lens and I have to shoot immediately, 8 is a good value, 5.6 could be critical. Some lenses perform better with 11. But 8 is rule of thumb for medium quality lenses, that works nice, 8. So, and then we can see here the hyperfocal length is 5 and everything is fine. And why I think we shouldn't have shallow depths of field in our panorama? Again, we don't want to have any blurry stuff in the picture because we want to use that maybe for our scene. And when we have something in the scene that is sharp, then it becomes blurry. And then the panorama is all of a sudden sharp again. And in the background and in the foreground of the panorama, we have blurry areas. Then we have two focus areas that wouldn't work very well together. So we want to have the sharpest possible image, and we can blur it all ways down. But the other way around, even with deconvolution or something like that, we won't get really blurry stuff out of it. So know your hyperfocal length, know your sweet spot of the lens, and know which focal lengths you have. And then find the best distance here, where the hyperfocal length is very close to the lens and the focus point where you have your main interest. And then everything should be fine for your shooting a panorama for 3D. For an art panorama, that is a different story. Thanks for listening. Have fun with it. Bye-bye.